Hello friends, I am Srishti Jain and today we are going to do next 5 questions of finance. Today's questions are really important as they relate to the FEO Act, RRBs, RN Malhotra Committee and some important concepts of Indian financial system. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel for more related videos and regular updates. Now, starting with the first question for today. The first question says, Mallya is the first business person to be declared as fugitive economic offender on a plea of the Enforcement Directorate. What are the criteria for declaring a person as FEO, that is fugitive economic offender, under FEO Act 2018? So three options have been given and you have to tell me that what are the correct criterias. So before disclosing the answer, let's first have a basic understanding of FEO Act in the next slide. Now, I'm sure you all must be knowing that who is he? He is Vijay Mallya, the first business person to be declared as FEO. So, banks accused Mallya of willfully defaulting on the debts of Kingfisher Airlines. So, these are the three criterias involved here. The first criteria is of the arrest warrant. So, who is a fugitive economic offender? So FEO means any individual against whom a warrant for arrest in relation to a scheduled offense has been issued by any court in India, who has left India to avoid criminal prosecution or being abroad refuses to return to India to face the criminal prosecution, as in the case of Vijay Mallya. Now you must be wondering that what scheduled offense means. So, scheduled offense means any offense specified in the schedule if the total value involved in such offense or offenses is equal to 100 crore rupees or more. So, the value should be this much. Only then it will be considered as a scheduled offense. Now, moving back to the question. So, the question says, an arrest warrant has been issued against the person. So, this is one of the criteria. Value involved in the case is rupees 200 crores or more. So, this is not true because the people offending for 100 crore rupees or more, but below 200 crore rupees will be neglected if this statement is considered to be true. So, that is why this is not the correct one, because it is not 200 crores or more, but rather it is 100 crores or more. Then the third statement says the person has left the country and refuses to face the prosecution. Here prosecution means criminal prosecution. So here the correct answer will be option 1 and 3, that is option C. Now moving on to the next question for today. So guys, this question is really interesting. Now this question says that regional rural bank provide loans and other financial assistance to entrepreneurs in the villages, suburban areas and small towns. Every bank requires some source of funds to run its business. So what is a source of funds for RRBs? So here specifically source of funds is asked for RRBs, that is regional rural banks. So the options are own funds, deposits, borrowings from RBI, borrowings from NABARD and sponsor banks. So let me tell you the correct answer and then we will be discussing some important things about RRBs. So own funds is there, deposits is there, borrowings from NABARD is there, sponsor banks is there and other sources including SEBI and NHB is also considered. So the correct answer over here will be 1, 2, 4, 5. Now you must be thinking that what is source of funds? Because often the students get confused between source of funds and the other term is with which student get confused is the application of funds. So we will be discussing first the difference between source of funds and application of funds and then we will be discussing the structure of RRBs and some amendments related to it. So guys, the source of funds means from where a bank is getting its money. So, a bank can get a money from deposits or from borrowings as we have discussed in the case of RRBs. Then, application of funds will be where a bank spends its money. So, it spends its money on loan. So, where it is using the funds will be considered as application of funds. And from where the funds are being received by a bank, it will be the source of funds. Now, let's discuss what structure RRB follows. So guys, the current structure is that central government have a 50% stake, sponsoring banks have 35% stake and state government have 15% stake. Now, what is the amendment that I want to discuss with you? So the amendment is that if RRB wishes to raise money from the sources other than central government, sponsoring bank or the state government, then it can do so. But keeping in mind that the combined stake of the central government and sponsoring bank should not fall below 51%. Additionally, if the shareholding of the state government in the RRB is reduced below 15%, then the central government would have to consult the concerned state government. So this is the amendment that I wanted to discuss with you. Now, moving on to the next question for today. The question is, to improve the financial system in India, various committees were formed in the past and in present too. In 1993, Government of India set up a committee under the chairmanship of R.N. Malhotra, a former governor of RBI, to propose recommendations in which of the following area. So, a committee was formed, that is R.N. Malhotra committee was formed in 1993 by RBI. Now, we will be discussing the timeline of this in the next slide and then we will be moving back to this question to answer it. So guys, in 1991, what happened? Government of India begins the economic reforms program and the financial sector reforms. In 1993, Committee on Reforms in the Insurance Sector, headed by Mr. R.N. Malhotra, the retired governor of RBI, was set up to recommend the reforms. In 1994, the Malhotra committee recommends certain reforms having studied the sector and hearing out the stakeholders. So some recommended reforms were, first, private sector companies should be allowed to promote the insurance companies. Second is, foreign promoters should also be allowed to do so. And the third is that government to vest its regulatory powers on an independent regulatory body which will be answerable to the Parliament. So, based on R.N. Malhotra Committee, IRDA, that is Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority, was formed in the year 1999. Now, moving back to the question to answer it. So, the Malhotra Committee focused on which sector? It focused on the insurance sector. So, guys, do join a Telegram channel and group for free material which will be really beneficial for your examinations. The link is provided in the description below. Now, the next question for today is, the entire financial system was under the state ownership and control till the mid-80s. Steps were initiated during phase 3 to privatize the important financial institutions. One of the outstanding developments in this fair was the conversion of the Pioneer Development Finance Institution in the country into a public company. So, identify this development finance institution being talked about in the question. So guys, if you think that this question is vague, then it is not, because the key point to catch here is the Pioneer Development Finance Institution. And Pioneer means the first development finance institution in the country. And as a finance student, you must know that the first development finance institution in India was IFCI, which was established in the year 1948. So we will be talking about this and the other institutions in the next slide. But for now, we have got our answer, that is Industrial Finance Corporation of India. So option A is the correct answer over here. So as I've already told you that IFCI was formed in the year 1948. So it is the first pioneer development finance institution to be converted to public company as IFCI Limited, and IDBI and IFCI Limited then offered their equity to the private investors. The next is NIDC. So NIDC is National Industrial Development Corporation, and it was established in the year 1954 to provide both finance and entrepreneurship. Although the ambitious in conception was different, it ultimately degenerated into a financing agency for the modernization of cotton and jute textiles. The next one is RCI. Now, what RCI is? It is a refinance corporation of industry which was established in the year 1958 to provide refinance to the banks against the term loans granted by them to the medium and small enterprises. And subsequently, RCI was merged with IDBI in the year 1964. Then we have IIBI. So, Industrial Investment Bank of India was formed by transforming the Industrial Reconstruction Bank of India. And it was set up by IDBI at the instance of the Government of India in April 1971 for the rehabilitation of sick industrial companies. And IRBI was incorporated under the Companies Act 1956 and renamed as the Industrial Investment Bank of India in March 1997. Then we have SEBI, which was established in the year 1990, and it is the subsidiary of IDBI for fostering the development of small and medium enterprises. Now, after discussing some major development finance institutions, let's move to the next and the last question for today. So, the question says that phase 2 marked the evolution of the financial system in India. One of its aspects was a progressive transfer of its important constituents from the private ownership to the public control. In which of the following year RBI was nationalized? And I guess that most of you know the answer of this question. So guys, phase 2 starts from 1951 to the mid 80s. And what does nationalization means? It means when the private sector companies or the assets is transferred to the public sector. And when the opposite happens, that is the assets of the public sector is transferred to private sector, that will be termed as privatization, which happened in phase 3 of our Indian financial system. So the year in which RBI was nationalized was the year 1948, that is option B, and it marked the beginning of the transfer of important financial intermediaries to the government control. And this was followed in 1956 by setting up of the State Bank of India by taking over the then Imperial Bank of India. And then many more nationalization was done. So with this, we have completed 5 questions of finance for today. I hope that you enjoyed today's series and you got to understand new concepts and terms. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon. If you have any doubt, any query, then do not hesitate to ask it in the comment section below. Thank you for watching my video.